last time.
Yes.
Does it change the mass level?
Yes, in general it will change the mass level.
QB does not change. QB?
QB of course is defined once and for all. Okay. So QB cohomology remains exactly the same, right? Because it is the same operator. But UB has a different operator. So that can certainly change the mass level.
We can think of QB hat as the BRST operator for the theory defined around shifted vacuum.
That's right, yes. So QB hat is a new BRST operator after you take into account all the loop corrections. Okay. And what about mass phenomenon you have in the loop corrections? So it will go into the into QB hat. Right? So for example, when you try to solve this QB hat chi equal to 0, okay, we give the momentum to be undetermined till the very end. Right? At the end, we said that we take the matrix, right, look for the zero eigenvalues, and that will appear for some specific values of the momentum, k square, right, and those are the denominators of mass mass. Right? So, if you instead, if you use QB and repeated the same exercise, then we will find that those will be the original mass square that we calculated in the by standard part of the three-level mass square. Is that? Okay, so today we will discuss the notion of global supersymmetry. Okay, and this will be the last formal thing before we start doing some jumping. Okay, so let me begin by explaining what this means. So we wrote down the gauge transformation laws around the shifted vacuum yesterday, last time, and that was on the form delta pi equal to qb hat pi, qb hat lambda, plus various other terms which you could write as sum n equal to 1 to infinity. I could put n equal to 0 to infinity, but the part is because it has double prime, n really starts from 1 upwards. That's n equal to 0 to this. So this was a general gauge transformation law. Okay, so this is local gauge transformation. And now, because we will be allowing both NS and Ramon sector, we have to put G in front of this. So, on NS sector, it was what we wrote down yesterday. On the Ramon sector, there is a chi naught sitting here. So, global supersymmetry, including, so this includes. Will pick some specific lambdas for which this term is 0. Now what is the rationale for this? The rationale for this is that if we have a lambda that satisfies this, then the variation of the field vanishes when evaluated from the vacuum. Because chi equal to 0 is a shifted vacuum. Right? Chi equal to 0 is the shifted downstate. So when you set chi equal to 0, if the vacuum doesn't change under certain supersymmetric transformation laws, that's what we'll call global supersymmetry. Okay, so these are the analog of the Killing spinners in supertrap. Okay, the Killing spinners satisfy the condition that when you vary various fields, then the various variances when evaluated on the original background. Is this clear? Okay, so this is the definition of the global supersymmetry that we'll be using. Okay. And we will focus on supersymmetries of the transverse and invariant vacuum. So the kind of lambda that we'll be looking for will be the ones which carry zero momentum. Okay, so focus on lambda carrying zero momentum.
I don't see why it's supersymmetry that work on this transformation and not some.
If you take lambda in the Raman sector, then it's supersymmetry. If you take lambda in the NS sector, then it's like ordinary global symmetry.
It is?
Ordinary global symmetry, right, generated by bosonic operators. So, yes, supersymmetry requires generated by lambda. This lambda has to belong to H minus half. Okay, in the Raman sector. Because supersymmetry is generated by spinors, right? I mean, supersymmetry transformation laws would be spinors, so they should belong to the Raman set.
This QB, yes. This is the BRST chair, right?
That's right. No, QB hat.
Yeah, QB hat. Yes. So, this we can define for boson, for supersymmetric or non-supersymmetric theories.
Yes.
Both. But and usually, how do I know? Suppose I have been working with non-supersymmetric theories.
Yes.
There also, if I state conditions like this, then
yes.
How will it be? I mean, how is it?
See, this is saying that the vacuum, okay, that there is not part of the global. So we are assuming that the theory has local supersymmetry.
Yes.
Right, because. As soon as you allow gauge transformation parameters in the Raman sector, there is local supersymmetry, right? You have local symmetry generated by scalar parameters. Now, if certain values of the parameters have the property that the change in the radial scales vanishes on the vacuum, then that's what we call global symmetry.
Yes.
Right? Because then the change in the field is proportional to the field and possibly higher orders.
Yes.
Okay. So, if you have a non-supersymmetric theory, right? Suppose you have a supersymmetric theory but compactified or something which breaks all supersymmetries, then you shouldn't be able to find solution to this equation. To this equation.
Okay.
Then you may still have local supersymmetry, but no global symmetry. Right? It's like if you have a general coordinate theory of gravity, right? There will be some background, like vacuum, which preserves transition invariance. Right? There will be other vacuum which breaks transition invariance. Right? So for those, so the analog of this in the Raman sector, if you take H minus 1, will be that for the vacuum, you should be able to find solutions to QB lambda equal to 0 for lambda which correspond to transition generators. Okay, general coordinate transformations which are rigid, which just correspond to transition. Those are the symmetries of the vacuum, right? Okay, not all general coordinate transformations leave the vacuum unchanged. Right? It takes the physical vacuum is unchanged, but a classical solution, vacuum written as a classical solution, like g mu equal to eta mu, will not remain eta mu in a different coordinate system.
Yes.
Okay. But translations are special kinds of general coordinate transformations,
yes,
which preserve vacuum. Okay. Lorentz transformations are also similar. Okay. So supersymmetry also fits in the same spirit. Okay. The supersymmetric transformations are symmetries, okay, such that when you change the field, the constant term vanishes. Okay.
Yeah.
This is what would mean that the vacuum, evaluated on the vacuum, okay, the variation is zero.
Yes, sir, but why is it that the BRST charge
yes.
is doing that? I mean, so
because BRST charge is what is appearing in the gauge transformation loss. Because you know that this is symmetry for any lambda.
Yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So we are looking for a transformation which is also a symmetry of that, right?
Yes.
Not any transformation.
Yes.
So the BRST charge is there because it just appears in this transformation law.
Okay.
Right? Like in the, if you take normal quadratic, right? You have delta psi mu equal to d mu epsilon. Right? The d mu happens to appear in the transformation law of psi mu.
Okay.
And there the Killing spinor condition is d mu epsilon equal to 0.
Okay.
right? Because you don't want the homogeneous piece, right? You don't want a field independent piece, right? You could ask why does Renu appear there?
Mm.
It appears there simply because Renu is what appears in a rational form.
Okay.
Right? Okay. So QBR is playing the role of Renu in the healing spiral equation.
Okay. So can I say that this BRC charge, this is correspond, this particular one is corresponding to the fixing of local supersymmetry that I had in the original theory?
No, we are not fixing anything. So, this is still a full symmetric transformation.
Yes, sir. Right? So this
now
is
we are looking for special class of these gauge symmetries,
mm-hmm. Yes.
Right? Which do not have the constants.
Okay.
Right? Fact that QB hat happens to be a BRST operator of the world shape theory,
yes.
That you can even forget. It's just some operator that is appearing in the gauge transformation,
okay.
Right? What appears in the action.
Mm-hmm.
And based on that, you can say that when there is a lambda that satisfies QB hat lambda equal to 0,
mm-hmm.
The transformation is a global symmetric transformation.
Okay.
Right? So QB hat you just think of as DU,
yes.
Right? Which appears in the gauge transformation law.
Mm-hmm.
And because it appears in the gauge transformation law, when you are trying to look for global symmetries,
mm-hmm.
You have to look for transformations which have dμ epsilon equal to 0.
Yeah.
Right? So lambda is like epsilon and qb hat is like dμ.
Okay.
Is that?
So
it doesn't have anything to do with zero momentum, but if you are looking for global supersymmetries of the vacuum, for example, right, then the spinners that we use are transition invariant spinners. Right? So you look for,
mm-hmm.
If you are looking for global supersymmetries of the vacuum, then you look for zero momentum states. Right? So you look for solutions for lambda which carry zero momentum.
So if we have some different symmetry, some different gauge symmetry, it will correspond to different condition on lambda.
It will correspond to different lambda. No, it will be the same condition, QB at lambda equal to zero. But then you look for lambda of a different type. Right?
So just by looking at this equation, can one figure out what will be the gauge group or, I mean, we have this gauge symmetry. But
well, no, this by itself will not tell us what the gauge group is. You have to look at the nonlinear part of the transformation law, which may give you some idea of what the gauge group is. Right? For example, if the transformation law is just like this, just this, right? No nonlinear term, then this would be like an abelian gauge transformation. So just from this, right, this of course has a full gauge transformation laws, but if you want to fit it into your usual notion of supergravity, right, that may not be very easy. You have to actually examine term by term and try to guess that how you write an effective field theory, right, integrating out all the massive states, then what kind of gauge transformation might correspond. Because here you have not integrated out anything, right? So just by looking at this, you will not directly know, right, what gauge transformation might correspond to after you have integrated all the massive things. Okay, but often you can guess, because once you have that first nonlinear term, right, first field as a parameter term, then you can also already guess what kind of gauge transformation might correspond. Okay. So here I am calling it supersymmetry because we will be looking for state in the Raman sector. Right? So it's a spinner value transformation parameter, and that's what you normally call supersymmetry. Right? So it's supersymmetry only because of this. Okay? And it's global because of this condition. Right? Otherwise, any lambda generates a local supersymmetry. That we have already seen. Right? This is an exact symmetry of that. Is this clear? Okay. So QB hat lambda, let me write my most explicit form. So QB hat lambda is QB lambda plus sum over n 1 to infinity. Okay, now we have to put the G in front here. Okay, because in general, in particular, if you are looking in the Raman sector lambda, psi classical of course is in the Neuschwitz sector. Okay, so this whole thing is the Raman sector states. So you have a chi zero. Okay, but just to keep things general, let me write this. So this I'll write as QB plus k plus gk lambda, where k is what we define just as, sorry, k lambda is a equal to 1, 2, 3. And like last time, we know that k is of order g string. Okay, it's of order g string because the n equal to 1 term here, okay, which will correspond to just square bracket of lambda, that gets contribution only at one loop level, okay, one loop and higher. Okay. Whereas the n equal to 2 term onwards, okay, has an explicit factor of psi classical. And psi classical is already of order gs. So this of order k is of order gs. And this we'll use to iteratively solve this equation. Okay, at least we'll see what it means, what it requires to solve this equation. Okay, because whatever you have been doing, we have been solving everything in a power series expansion and g string. Okay, and we'll do the same thing for lambda. Okay, we'll try to look for a solution to this equation in a power series expansion. Okay, starting from the T-level supersymmetric transforms to the parameters, and then building up the corrections by possible. Okay, and then we will see what kind of obstruction we may encounter along the way. Okay, and if we encounter an obstruction, that will correspond to supersymmetric means spontaneously broken, right? Because it was there at T-level. Okay, and then at some order, you find that it's not there anymore. Okay, local supersymmetry is still there. Okay, so the global supersymmetry could have been spontaneous.
So, can we
find more than one solution for lambda? Yeah, in general, of course, you'll find more than one solution because.
Higher order solutions.
Well, even n equal to 1 in 4 dimensions, we have 4 different solutions for lambda. Because the spinner has 4 components, right? So, in that sense, there will be always more than one. Okay, the spinner has 4 components, right? So, for every component, you'll get a solution. You just count the number of global supersymmetries.
So from that you get your
four supersymmetries. Yeah. In 4 dimensions, if you find that there are 4 global supersymmetries, then you know that it's an equal to one supersymmetry.
So my precise question would be then, how is this QB related to the supercharge?
No, QB is not related to supercharge. Then because the QB is used for all gauge transformations. QB is like DU. Right?
Yes.
EMU is not related to supercharge.
Yes, exactly.
EMU is a covariant derivative, right?
Yes.
So you should have asked this question in supercharge, right? Mm-hmm. Delta psi mu equal to d mu epsilon. So you are solving for d mu epsilon equal to 0 to find out the Killing spinners.
Yes.
Right? Which of course in flat background just reduces to d mu epsilon equal to 0.
Mm-hmm.
And d mu has nothing to do with supercharge.
Yes.
Right? So QB hat is just the operator which determines what the supercharge transformation parameter is. Supercharge is lambda, I mean, the supersymmetric transformation parameter is lambda.
Yeah.
Right? And supercharge is whatever generates.
Yes.
Okay, so QB is not related to supercharge at
all.
Yes. Okay, because it's the same QB you will use for the Lebesgue sector, Ramone sector, any other sector that you can use. Right? In type 2, NSNS, NSR, RNS, and RR, all you have. All of you have global supersymmetric transformation parameters.
Except
NSNS. No, even NSNS. Lambda,
oh,
okay. A normal transition invariance, right? Is in the NSNS sector, in type. So this is a general feature. For supersymmetry, we are utilizing to the Ramone sector, right? We are assuming we are heterotic description. Otherwise, if it's a type 2 description, you look for either H minus 1 minus half or minus half minus. Right. RNS or NS. Okay. Both sectors may have global supersymmetries.
So the statement that supersymmetry is
preserved
up to all orders is that this equation has
solution to all orders.
Can be solved to all orders.
Yeah, can be solved to all orders. Exactly.
What happened to the psi tilde fields, the virtual fields that you are introduced?
The which fields?
Psi tilde.
Well, psi tilde are just eliminated by solving equation of motion. They can be eliminated because you can always set psi tilde, you can solve the equation by setting psi tilde equal to g psi or the other way, psi equal to g psi tilde. Because in the equation of motion, right, psi tilde equation is just linear as you saw. Right? So those are solved once and for all, three level, and you don't worry about them. But psi tilde equation doesn't have a higher order. Right? Psi tilde equation is this qb times g psi minus psi, g psi tilde minus psi equal to 0. Right? So the difference between g psi tilde and psi is always just a solution to the free field equation. Okay, for most purposes, psi tilde was there to provide the action. Okay, but you don't really need to worry about psi tilde. Okay, for example, the analog of the lambda tilde gauge transformations, right? There is a lambda tilde, right? That just will satisfy a free field equation and you just forget about that, the lambda tilde. Okay, that is just qb lambda tilde equal to 0, global supersymmetry. But those global supersymmetries will never see anywhere because those will change psi tilde, right? And you don't care about what happens to psi tilde. Okay, are there other questions? So let us see how to go about solving this, and we will do the standard trick. Namely, we will expand lambda in a power series expansion. And we will define lambda k to be the solution to kth order. Okay, the only difference between lambda and lambda k is that you have truncated it at order gs to be k, and then lambda k satisfies that q be lambda k, q be at lambda k in order gs to be plus 1, and this I can write as q be at q be lambda k plus g k lambda k minus 1. Okay, so what I have done here is I have allowed us to make an error of order gs to be k in lambda k. Okay, I replace lambda k minus 1 because that will combine with the order gs contribution to k to make the contribution order gs to k plus 1. But this allows us to take it to the other side and solve the equation. So q be lambda k, I can write this as minus g k lambda k minus 1 plus order gs to k plus 1.
In the expansion of lambda, it will have some of the order gs to the power 0.
Yes, because overall normalization of lambda is completely arbitrary.
So, there, when we are replacing lambda k by lambda k minus 1,
yes,
will not we pick up in terms of the order, I mean, less than gs to the power k? Or
no, because the point is that the difference between lambda k minus 1 and lambda k is of order gs to the k. So when I replace lambda k by lambda k minus 1, right, in this I make an error of order gs to the k. Okay? And then k has an explicit factor of gs, right, that will make it gs to the k plus 1. Is that, yeah? So this is a linear problem, you are not trying to solve take products of any lambdas, then you have to worry about the kind of thing that you are worried about. Okay? But here is just one lambda k, right? All I am saying is that we make an error, allow an error of order gs to the k here, that just combines with order k stuff. Okay, so the first consistency check, which is like what we did last time. So qb on any case is 0, will require that QB on G K lambda Q 1 plus 1 to be ordered based to be K plus 1. Okay, otherwise you cannot satisfy this. So this we can easily prove, okay, using the fact that we have QB hat square is zero. Okay, so this means that QB plus G square is zero. But QB square of course is zero, so QB GK plus GK QB plus GK square is zero. Okay. Using that we can write QB on GK minus GK QB minus GK square, that's what I have written here. But now we notice that this is of order GS to be K. Okay, because lambda K minus 1 satisfies that equation. QB plus GK on lambda K minus 1 should be order GS to be K.
So it's a square bracket.
Here, well, the point is the way I am thinking of applying K, right? Yes, it is, there is a square bracket here, that's a state, right? But I write this as K on lambda. It's just a notation.
Okay, okay.
Right?
Okay.
K on lambda means this.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Is this clear?
Yeah.
Right? It's a linear operation on lambda, right? It gives, it takes a lambda and gives you a state. Right? So you can just think of as an operator acting on it. So now we see that this is order GS. Okay, so this product becomes order GS to the Q plus 1. Okay, which is what we want to prove. Right? Because you want to prove this and indeed that is the case.
By this we are assuming that we know lambda k minus
1. Yes, because you are doing it iteratively. We are assuming that you know lambda k minus 1 or can determine lambda k.
Otherwise this equation won't determine a part which is like QB of some parameter which is in that GK lambda. So we are basically using QB at square equal to 0.
Yes.
Apply QB on this side. On both sides of this equation.
Yeah, QB square is also 0. Okay. So you are applying QB on both sides of this equation and this we get that this is a consistency condition. We have to check. Right? And what we did here is to check that consistency condition. Right? The QB on GK lambda minus 1. Okay, given that lambda by k minus 1 should satisfy the lower order equation, then as long as that is true, QB on GK lambda k minus 1 should be 0 identical. Right? That's all we do. Okay. So given this, we can now solve for lambda. We have one done this before in a similar context. So you introduce P as a projection operator n0 plus equal to 0 state. And then write that, rewrite that equation as qb lambda k equal to minus 1 minus p gk lambda k minus 1 plus or minus p gk lambda k minus 1 the order gs to be plus 1. And so the solution to this is minus d0 plus where p tau k is projected into zero plus equal to zero states, and q beta of it is minus p exactly this term. When QB acts, goes through, okay, and acts on this, QB of course converges with P, right? Because P is an L0 plus projection of water, and QB converges to L0 plus. So QB directly applies to GK lambda K minus 1. But that we have seen from here is of order GS to the K plus 1. Okay? So that term we don't care because you are allowing errors of order GS to the K plus 1. So this solves the equation in the sector projected by 1 minus. Okay, you don't have to do anything. But similar thing cannot be done on this sector because L0 plus in the denominator will diverge. Okay, that's solved separately, like tau k. And then tau k is in L0 plus equal to 0 sector, say, and it has to separately satisfy this equation. Okay, so tau k you cannot write as E0 plus over L0 plus on something, okay, you really have to go ahead and try to solve this equation. But this is again a finite dimensional matrix equation because L0 plus equal to 0, okay, and K equal to 0, okay, that's finite dimensional vector space. Right? So you can write tau K as a general linear combination of arbitrary states and solve the matrix. Is this clear? So this is the way one will try to build the supersymmetric transformation at arbitrary order. Okay. So only thing now we have to worry about is whether this equation can always be solved. Okay. Can there be obstacles to solving this equation? Yes.
So what we do here is very similar to what we did last time when we were looking for the spectrum.
Yes,
because
exactly.
It's the same equation. Except that
yeah. Here.
But so last time, for this tau k,
yes.
You were writing bn, where the n was not depending on...
Yes, because see, last time, there is a slight difference from what you did last time. Because last time, we were trying to look for the spectrum, so the momentum was not fixed. Right? And we determined the momentum at the very end, right? By solving the, like, those higher value equations. Here, the momentum is already fixed. Okay, so we don't have to determine the momentum again. So that's the reason why here, okay, we don't have to solve the whole problem first and then go back because there's nothing to adjust, right? That it's either a solution at this order or it's not a solution. See, last time the point is there are the momentum which you want to adjust at the very end, right? To see under what condition you can get solutions. Right? Here there's nothing to solution, so nothing to adjust. So if there's an obstruction at say kth order, right? There is nothing that you can adjust to remove that obstruction. Right? It's an algorithmic obstruction because lambda k minus 1 is completely determined. Right? So this equation, right hand side of this equation is completely determined. Right? There is nothing you can do to adjust anything, and hence this will also be determined. Is this? Minus because of?
In the last equation,
right? Oh, maybe I think it's plus. But if you want to do the way we did it last time, of course you can do this, right? You just skip tau k fixed arbitrary linear combination and determine those coefficients after you have at the very end. Then you just keep iterating, keeping tau k completely undetermined, assuming that there is some linear combination. Right? And at the very end, you try to see if that satisfies, that this equation can satisfy. Okay, now let me describe the possible obstruction to solve this. Okay, and it's easy to see that the obstructions that have been discussed are the only kind of obstructions that you may have.
Here, tau k will change at every order.
Well, tau k by definition is tau k at kth order. Right? Yes, so next order, when you look for tau k, right? Up to the order gs to the k minus 1, you have already determined it. Right? So, up to that order, you just keep whatever you have determined. And then you add to it. A set of the order gs to the k.
But bn was, I mean, we fixed it once and for all. I mean, it was arbitrary linear combination of.
Which one?
Bn, I mean, yesterday analysis.
Yes, it was an arbitrary linear combination, but those that linear combination could have gs dependent coefficients. Right? And in general, there are gs dependent coefficients. Right? So once you determine it, you can expand it in powers of gs. Right? And you can see what is the form of the vector up to a given order in GS.
So it means BN will change at every order. I mean,
yes, so BN will change at every order. So if you keep, you have fixed N, right? If you change the value of N, then you will find that the BN has changed. Right? Once
when you fix N, so what we did was, I mean, we fixed N and then we iterated from, I mean, first order, then second order, third order, and we went up to nth order.
Yeah, assuming that that particular linear combination is whatever it is.
Yeah.
Right?
Those coefficients will change in every order.
Exactly. So those coefficients will change in every order. So when you expand out BL as a function, as a power series in G at the end, right, those coefficients will change in every order. Okay? But the reason that we did it that way, right, and not try to solve for bn at every order, is also the momentum will change. Right? Momentum becomes a function of gs. Right? So that's why it was easier to first do the whole iteration and then determine momentum at one go, okay, by looking solving the matrix equation. Is this okay? Because why we do it, couldn't have fixed the momentum. Okay, that's the point. That if we fix momentum, suppose you take the s square equal to m square and determine it at the lowest order, right? And at the next order in perturbation theory, you set s square equal to m square. Then you know that you have a divergent expansion, right? Because the way normally the propagator arises, right, is that there is a 1 over k square minus m square plus delta m square, you expand it out as 1 over k square minus m square plus delta m square over k square minus m square whole square and so on. You will get a divergence, right? So you couldn't set k square equal to the 3 level m square and calculate the first order correction. You have to keep k square arbitrary to be able to calculate the first order correction. Right? Otherwise, you will get divergence in the intermediate stage of the calculation. That's why in the last time's calculation, we kept k to be undetermined. Right? And that's why because we kept k to be undetermined, bx also couldn't be determined because those depend on the value of. So you give k undetermined, right? Construct the matrix, okay, up to whatever order you want to go. And at that order you solve for k by solving that matrix equation. If you now substitute that value of k and try to calculate next order correction, okay, you will run into divergence again, right? Because you will get two powers of that in the denominator. So that's why you have to work with generic k, yeah, and that's the optional formalism is necessary for mass normalization, right? That you have to keep k generic, first calculate the propagator and then determine k by looking at the polys. But here that problem is not there, right? K is equal to 0 to begin with, so we might as well solve it iteratively and then determine whether there is an obstruction at any stage. Okay, now let's look at the possible obstructions. Where can it come from? So let's suppose that you have a state psi. This belongs to h minus 3 half as ghost number 3, each number number they say, ghost number 3 L0 plus 0 k equal to 0. And this is an element of the RST. Means q is i equal to 0, okay. But xi is not p beyond some state. Okay, why I have use this property, so it will become clear in a way. So, if we now calculate xi c0 minus qb tau k, I perhaps should have told you that the lambda k's all are ghost number 1, they are dx transforms of lambda, right? Because delta psi is equal to qb lambda, right? So since qb has ghost number 1, right, psi has ghost number 2, lambda has ghost number 1. So tau k also has ghost number 1, right? Because this is exactly as that in the exclusive for lambda. So then we see from here that xi of this ghost number and that picture number can possibly have a non-zero lambda. It's not ruled out by the ghost number and picture number conservation. Right? Because this is ghost number 3 plus 1, that is 4, plus 1 plus 1, that's 6. Okay. Tau k has picture number minus half, yeah? Because lambda was an element of h minus half. This has picture number minus half, xi has picture number minus 3 half, so you can, that is a picture number. But nevertheless, because of this condition, this is actually zero. Okay, the way you see it zero is as you just take qb to the left. The anti-commutator of qb with c0 minus is not zero, but it doesn't have a c0 minus a on it. Right? So that's the standard reason that we have been giving. That as long as these are in HNs, okay, this matrix element is zero. Because none of these have any c0 minus. So this would mean that the matrix element of xi with this must be ordered GST with U plus 1. It's You see, Xi was a BRST trivial state, right? If Xi had the form of QBS, then this would be automatic. Because if Xi is QBS, then you can just print QB here, okay? Pass QB through C0 minus, the same argument. And then QB on this will be ordered GS to the K plus 1 because of this condition. So if Xi was a BRST trivial state, okay, then this condition will be automatic. But if Xi is a non-trivial element of BRST cohomology, namely if it's BRST invariant but not BRST trivial, then in general this condition is not, does not follow from anything that we have already seen. Is this clear? So for every Xi of this type, we have to check this condition at every order. If this condition is satisfied for every Xi, then you can show that this equation can be solved. Okay, this matrix equation that you get here actually has a solution that the matrix can get by. Okay, on the other hand, if this fails, that means that you cannot find a solution to this order. Is this clear? So this actually has a physical interpretation of what this possible failure represents. Let me try to explain that. So if we take this inner product, AC0 minus B, then this pairs most number 3 state, most number 3, feature number minus 3 half state A with most number 2. Number adds up to minus 2, minus 3 up plus minus half. Whose number adds up to 6 because it's 3 plus 1 plus 2, that's 6. Okay? So a pairing of this type will pair if whose number 3 picture number minus 3 half state with whose number 2 picture number minus half state. Okay? So in particular, a Xi of that type that we see there, okay, will be paired with a whose number 2 picture number minus half state. Because Xi has host number 3, picture number minus 3. Yes, so HN, but I have already specified the picture numbers. This is minus 3 half, this is minus half. Okay, I have written HN because I could, otherwise I have to write separately H minus 3 half for AN, H minus half for B. Is this clear? Okay. So one can also show that this kind of pairing, okay, actually pairs physical with physical and unphysical with pure gauge. Okay, unphysical states are the ones which are not added by BRST operator. Pure gauge states are the ones which are of the form QB on lambda. Now, why is that pairing? You can see that suppose this was a pure gauge state. Okay, suppose these are the pure gates, okay? Then if A is either physical or pure gauge, then this inner product will vanish. Right? Because qb square is equal, right? If it's because well, qb square, if this is pure gauge, then it's qb on s, right? Qb can be taken through c to 0 minus and qb on a is equal to 0 if a is either physical or pure gauge. Okay? So a pure gauge state can pair with unphysical state. Okay? Similarly, a pure gauge state here pairs with unphysical state. And a physical state pairs with physical. So this means that for every physical state psi, okay, that whenever you have a physical state psi there, okay, you also have a physical state of Bose number 2, picture number minus, just by this pair. Okay. So for every psi in H minus 3 mark of Bose number 3, we have a physical state of Bose number 2 in H minus 1. But this, of course, now have a physical interpretation. Okay? Bose number 2 is a physical state. Okay? Picture number minus half. Okay? That's also the sector in which we have taken our physical states to be. Okay? These are k equal to 0, L0 plus equal to 0. Right? So these correspond to 0 momentum. Physical massless formulas. Right? So for every psi which could cause possible obstruction to that equation, for solving that equation, we have a zero momentum physical massless form. We can also reverse this. For every zero momentum physical massless form, there is a possible obstruction. Right? How to determine the obstruction? For every zero momentum physical massless form, you find this solving the state. Right? That's a candidate for psi which can have non-zero inner product. Is this clear? And in fact, it's, you can even give it a more direct interpretation. Now, this state over here that you are getting, P g k lambda k minus 1, okay, this is just invalid to this order because qb on this is 0. Okay. But if this contains a linear combination of physical states, then you are in trouble. This is guaranteed invariant, right? Because you have seen, well, that I just said qb on this is 0. Okay, to up to order gs to k plus 1 times, right? So qb on this is 0, so it's a linear combination of pure gauge and physical states. Okay. Now, if it contains a physical state, if in the linear combination a physical state appears, okay, and it could appear because there are physical states, the massless, physical massless formulas. So when we explain this as a linear combination of basis states, if those basis states, if those linear combinations include some over these, then we cannot solve this equation. Is this clear? Because then it's not qb on anything, right? This equation that we are trying to solve is qb on tau k is this. So unless this is pure gauge, this equation has no solution. The fact that qb on this tells us, qb on this is 0, tells us that it's a linear combination of pure gauge and physical states. But if this linear combination actually includes physical states, then this equals Russell solution. And that's what this is saying. Is this clear?
Can I think of it this way, that this equation having a physical state on that side means a state on this QB and I index?
Your guess is also other property. See, we have seen from a lower order analysis that QB on this should annihilate, right? Okay, from that point of view, you know that it cannot contain an unphysical state. Because QB on this annihilates it, right?
Only those terms are allowed which if they are of the form QB on X.
Or some, yes.
That can be taken on that side. And
yeah, because then you can just have said tau k equal to X, right? If this is of the form QB on S, right? Then you just say tau k equal to S and solve it. But if it contains a physical state, right? By definition, there is no tau k which solves that equation, right? Is that clear? Okay, that's the obstruction. Okay, so for every physical massless fermion that the theory has, there is a possible obstruction to solving the supersymmetry, the global supersymmetry conditions. This actually has a nice interpretation. Okay, this in particular means that if the theory didn't have physical massless fermions, then you are safe. Then global supersymmetry cannot be broken. Right? You can keep solving this equation. Okay, in fact, I mean, of course, if you have global supersymmetry, there is also a massless gravity, right? But gravity rules actually don't bother us because, I mean, just by Lorentz transformation properties, we look for lambda k, which are Lorentz spinners. The supersymmetry transformation parameters are Lorentz spinners. Right? Gravity rules, on the other hand, are Lorentz like, they have carry spin 3 half. Right? So they can never really appear in this linear. Right? Because this will be linear combination of spin off fermions only. Okay. So if the theory doesn't contain a massless spin off fermion, then you are safe. Okay, that's what this is saying. That then you can extend and solve this equation to all orders. Okay, once you have a zeroth order starting point. Right? Of course, you have to have a zeroth order starting point. If at zeroth order there is no solution to QB on lambda 0 equal to 0, right? Then there is nothing to iterate. Yeah, but given the QB lambda 0 equal to 0 solution, you can iterate it to all orders if there is no massless spin off fermion.
So the delay will be mass.
Suppose there is no delay point. Suppose you have somehow gotten rid of it. Right? Otherwise, you are right. If there, as long as there is a delay law, right, the delay law will be problem. Right? But if you imagine that you have gotten some complicated background that you have lifted at the Now, why is this so? Right? I mean, this actually can be understood physically. Okay? The reason that this is the case is because in order for supersymmetry to be broken, okay, it's a local supersymmetric theory of well, even local supersymmetry not needed. In order for supersymmetry to be broken, you need a Goldstein, okay, which is a massless fermion. You know that as associated with supersymmetry breaking, okay, there has to be a massless fermion. If the massless fermion was not there as zeroth order in partition theory, then it cannot appear in partition theory. Right? And as long as there is no massless fermion, supersymmetry cannot be broken because what's broken supersymmetry requires that there should be Goldstein. Right? So the obstructions that you are finding, right, the fact that this shouldn't contain a linear combination of those physical fermions, is essentially checking that none of the massless fermions can become a Goldstein node and break supersymmetry. Because for every possible massless fermion, there is a danger that supersymmetry may be broken at a given order, making that into a Goldstein node. Okay? The fact that that doesn't happen is what is being tested by this condition. Okay? Or equivalently, by testing that this doesn't contain and a linear combination of those massless fermions. Is this clear? So this also makes life easier when you are actually trying to look for supersymmetry breaking. Okay. Because if you have some understanding of house perspective may be broken in a given theory, right, by F dot or D dot or whatever, right, then you have a guess of what would be the corresponding Goldstone. Right? For example, if it's a D dot perspective breaking, then the Goldstone typically is the gauge, you know, that's the super button of the corresponding gauge. Okay, if it's an F dot breaking, then the Goldstone is typically the super symmetric partner of the chiral multiple, right? What's the formula in the chiral multiple, right? Whose F has gotten a non-zero vacuum as well. So in such cases, if you suspect that the super symmetric may be breaking by either an F term or a D term, then you know what the candidate Goldstone is. And then you have to check for that candidate Goldstone, if that candidate Goldstone appears in this. Okay. Or if you eventually find its conjugate state and calculate the magnitude. Yeah. Okay, and this is what we'll try to do with the explicit examples that we'll be discussing.
So the local H transformation as UV had on lambda class that there we didn't have any restriction on lambda.
No, that because local symmetries are always there, right? Even though you change background, right? Local symmetries remain local symmetries. Right? It's only the global symmetries depend on the background, right? Because there you are actually solving for qb hat lambda equal to 0.
I was trying to say that those kind of solutions were always also in this sort of solution.
Yes,
the physical masses, is it super symmetric, then there should be this. They are physical state, zero momentum masses.
Yes. So this is for global superspectrum. Right? Local superspectrum, right, will always be there. In any background. Right? And once you have started with the theory of local supersymmetry, but changing the background, you cannot change the fact that there is a local symmetry in the other theory. Then you can explicitly work out how the transformations will be in a given different background. Is this? Okay, it's just that if the transformation includes an inhomogeneous term, right, a piece that doesn't vanish, even when you set all the fields to their vacuum values, then we will say that the superset, this particular symmetry, is not a global symmetry, right, because the inhomogeneous term is non-zero, so the vacuum is actually changing, the actual vacuum solution is changing. Whereas if that term is zero, then the vacuum solution is not changing, and we will call this a Killing symmetry.
Since supersymmetry breaking is associated with Goldstone, then I mean this is the only possible obstruction that can arise because it is already giving me the
exactly.
Masses from your
from a physical point of view, you know that this is the only possible obstruction which could arise because if there are no massless formulas,
then
you shouldn't be able to break supersymmetry.
Right.
But you also see it from here, right? I mean, we can, this is a simple matrix algebra to show that once this condition is satisfied for all possible physical states, right, then you can solve this. Right? Because then that basically means that we already know that QB on this is zero.
Hmm.
Right? Those equations are telling us that this doesn't have any physical component.
Right.
Right? So this was a QB on something. Right? So you just say tau k equal to that something and that's what solves the equation. Okay. So this fits in with physical arguments that supersymmetry breaking should require Goldstone. Okay, and we see from here that indeed order by order in perturbation theory, right, the obstruction to getting global supersymmetry that would possibly have are related to existence of Goldstone, right, masses, particles.
So here it's Goldstone for the global supersymmetry.
For the global supersymmetry. Yes.
So if we break this global supersymmetry, we necessarily have a massless field. So I was thinking if we have some kind of X effect that for which this Goldstone become part of the.
Yeah. So that will happen of course later. Right? It will become part of the gravity law. right? And it will acquire a mass because of the maximum gravity, no? Right? But that will happen at
okay, so it's not at this step, is
at this stage, exactly. Yeah. So at this stage to break, to see the breaking of global supersymmetry, you will see the Goldstone law. Right? And then you will see that the Goldstone actually mixes with the gravity law. Right? And the whole thing becomes possible. So this existence of Goldstone law, okay, the fact that this represents a massless formula, this is a massless formula at the three level, right? Because these are just QB. In a cohomology of QB. Right? We are not using QB hat to determine whether they remain really remain massless. Right? And we do find that they will not remain massless at once you go to higher order. But all this is saying is that in order for supersymmetry to be broken in perturbation theory, there must be massless formulas at the P level, right, which could possibly become Goldstone candidates when it breaks. Right? And after that, it will acquire masses. But those masses will, of course, be of order GS and hat, right, because supersymmetry is broken, breaking at a low level. Okay, so now this basically ends the formal part of the lecture. So now I'll introduce an example and we'll discuss various things that we have seen in the context of an example. But this will be a class of examples. So these examples will include, will correspond to exophoric to heterotic. Yeah, these examples are interesting because this will be this basically illustrates all the features that we have seen that could happen in string theory. We will see that they do happen in this particular example, this particular class of examples. So let me describe this model a little bit. So what we'll do today, I think I'll give the space-time picture. Tomorrow I'll describe the worksheet description of these same theories, and then you can start doing explicit loop calculation. So Calabria of three folds have SU3 polynomial. Okay, these are folds we know. And type 2 compactification is perfectly sensible. Okay, it is also perfectly sensible. But for heterotic string theory, you have to do a little more work to get a sensible compactification. I should have said SU3 holonomy. This is important. What does SU3 holonomy mean? This essentially means the following, that if you construct the spin connection, omega I AB, where I is internal coordinate, and these are the internal tangent space index. Internal means on the Calabria manifold. So for a generic manifold, okay, without Calabria condition, omega AB would have been a connection in SO6. Okay, because you have six, this is 6 by 6 anti-symmetric matrix. Right, so that's an element of the SO6 item, right? And SO6 is a tangent space. But SU3 holonomy means that this belongs to the SU3 subgroup of SU6. Okay, SU2A has SUN as a subgroup. Okay, we discussed this yesterday. Okay, so SU6 has SU3 as subgroup. Okay, and for SU3 holonomy manifolds, the spin connection belongs to SU3. This clear? Now, why do you have problem in heterodic strength theory? So, in heterodic strength theory, if you look at the gauge invariant free form field strength, this is dB plus there is chance Simons term for gauge fields and then chance Simons term for gravity. Okay? This is the gauge invariant free form field strength that we have in heterodic strength. So this means that dH is proportional to trace FOHF minus trace R is R. So this is the Lorentz chance Simons term, this is the gauge chance Simons term. And if you just take D of this, okay, you get trace FOHF minus trace R is R. So in particular, if you integrate this over any 4 cycle, since H is a gauge invariant field strength, this of course is 0. But this would mean the integral over 4 cycle of this over here minus this R is R is not 0. Well, it's not 0, it's like this. So this is a consistency condition. Okay? Because integral dH must vanish. Okay, this is d of a gauge invariant free form, right? Well defined free form. So integral dH must vanish on any 4 by 4 cycle. That means the integral of this must also vanish on any 4 cycle. Okay? And typically this one doesn't vanish. Okay? When you integrate this over a 4 cycle on a Calabria manifold, it doesn't vanish. Okay? So here you have no choice. And R is determined by the SUH holonomy. You just calculate trace R with that SUH holonomy, integrate, and you find a non-zero result. And that means that this cannot vanish. The integral of trace FOHF cannot vanish. Then it must be adjusted to cancel this. So the simplest way that one can solve this, okay, but there are other ways, okay, more general ways. But the simplest way that one can solve this is the following. Which is to pick an SU3 inside SU32. And then switch on background gauge field mu in SU3 such that mu will be better. Okay, so omega mu has SU3 holonomy, that means this is a connection in an SU3 gauge. You can think of this as an SU3 connection. Right? So you just pick an SU3 inside SU42, switch on mu inside that, and set the value of mu to be exactly equal to omega mu that you have on the from the spin connection. If you do that, then point by point, trace FOHF minus trace ROHF vanishes. Right? Because point by point, F is equal to R. And that means you can just set A is equal to 0. Can say A is equal to 0. Because we have BH equal to 0, because this is point by point 0. And hence, you can solve this equation simply by setting H equal to 0. Right? This is the simplest possibility. So you consider the background without any free form. So this is what is often called embedding spin connection into the gauge connection. Okay? But there are more general solutions that we can have. Okay? For if it's not true that AB and omega mu are set equal point by point, even the gauge group may not be the same. You can use a bigger gauge group, for example, to see some gauge fields. But this integral condition always has two sides. Okay, so you can choose more general gauge groups, gauge field background, satisfying this. But we will focus on this. Yeah, on this particular class of compact configurations, where you set spin selection equal to gauge. So now we notice that if you take SO32, it has as a subgroup, a maximal subgroup, SO6 times SO32, SO26. And this has as a maximal subgroup U3, which is U1 times SO2, locally. And you can put the gauge fields inside this. The unbroken gauge group is U1 times SO26. Okay, and it's this U1 which is going to be a power interest. Because having a U1 means that in principle, in perturbation theory, you may generate a higher Laplace beta, okay, which could possibly break supersymmetry, okay, as we'll see later. And this is the reason why you have chosen SO32 heterotic. If you do a corresponding analysis for E8+8 heterotic, and do this embedding the spin collection to the gauge collection, then in the simplest case, the unbroken gauge group is E6 times E8. It doesn't have U1. Okay, but there are more general compact configurations of heterotic which can, even E8+8 heterotic, which has U1. Okay, and whenever you have an U1, you have this kind of possibilities that supersymmetry could break in principle by inducing some higher Laplace beta. Okay, so let me now describe what one means by higher Laplace beta. So potential of effective field theory. So now I am using the language of effective field theory. Effective one and field theory. And we will be focusing on one particular part of the potential which comes from the Fisher associativity terms. This typically has the following form, 1 over g square. So d is the auxiliary d field, this is the auxiliary field for the gauge U1 gauge multiplier. And these are the chiral multiplet scalars. And these are the charges, U1 charges of the scalars. scientifically has formed like this, and if we eliminate E, you basically get sum of what I qi phi s at phi s square. Okay, positive definite term. And so the quadratic vacuum is that phi I equal to 0. Okay, for the potential analysis. That is the standard scenario. But now suppose that at some order, okay, say one loop order, we generate a phi local income. What that means is that there is a possibility that you can generate a term like C G square G S square B. Okay. So this kind of term you couldn't have generated with any non-abelian entity, okay, because this would violate AC unsymmetric. Then you couldn't just put a GA, a DA here, okay, because nothing to contract with. Okay. But for U1, you can put a C G square B. And if you do that, then after you eliminate D, we get a potential of the form 1 over G square. So here if you look at quadratic vacuum, that's still phi I equal to 0. Right? Because phi I equal to 0 solves the equation of motion. Okay, it's still extremum. Phi I equal to 0. But here V is non-zero. This means the support symmetry is broken. Okay, that's one thing. Second will be that there is a dilaton dipole. Okay, so this term, after the full string theory, this will be replaced by e to the 2 phi. Right? This is a dilaton. Okay? So, because of this term, so there is a potential for the dilaton. Right? That means that the 1 point function of the dilaton is no longer 0. Del v del phi is no longer 0. Okay? So, there is a 1 to square root term energy. Okay? So, this gives you dilaton dipole. And cosmological constant. So, like we should say, Hamilton dipole, but that's what you should expect in string field theory. But this will happen at 2. Why two loops? Because it's already of it's of order c square. Okay? So 1 over j square, of course, is the overall factor. So when you expand it out, it's like c square j to the 4. That's the pattern we are seeing here. Right? So the supersymmetry will be broken at one loop. But the unit on that one will appear at two loops. And phi I will get mass. Mass square equal to CQI Okay, so one over gs square is an overall factor that multiplies actions. If we just expand it out, you get a c gs square qi. And that's what multiplies phi I star phi. If you expand it around a phi I equal to 0 vacuum, then the quadratic term c gs square qi. Number 2, that is 2 factors. That will appear at 1. Yeah, but one over ds square also multiplies kinetic term. One over ds square is the overall factor in the action, right? It multiplies the kinetic term and the potential term, so you just take it out. Right? And the term is really of order cgs square. The mass square will be of order cgs square. It's like 1 over gs square times del mu phi plus gs square phi phi, right? So you still call gs square as the mass. Even though the gs square actually cancels the 1 over gs square, that's the overall 1 over gs square.
That's why it's 1.
That's why it's 1, yes.
Because it, in that normalization, everything cancels.
Exactly. That's right. So T-level mass square is of order 1 and the 1 over mass square is of order 2. So in principle, all of these will be correlated. If in string theory, right, you have to see this, then we should be able to see that supersymmetry is broken at one loop. Okay. We'll see this by that abstraction. Okay. In this case, the abstraction, if it's a D-term supersymmetry breaking, the abstraction should be associated with the Gay genome, obviously one. Okay. You have to tackle two loops, you should be able to see by explicit calculation. Again, we'll see this in the string field theory analysis by saying that there is an obstruction to solving the Taylor field equations. Right? We will not see divergence, that therefore divergence, but we'll see there's an obstruction to solving the Taylor field equation. And similarly, we can calculate the normalized mass at one loop, and you should be able to see this. But there is another interesting aspect of this, right, which in fact is of perhaps more interest. And that is where you really need string field theory, and you cannot do with ordinary quantitative analysis. And that is, that comes from the following observation. Then if you look at this, then you can see that if C over QI is negative for some I, you may get another minimum where the potential actually vanishes. Okay? So if C over QI is less than 0, you may get a Suzy vacuum at phi I equal to square root minus C over UI times GS.
Pardon?
Other phi has to be 0. And phi j equal to 0 for j equal to 5. Okay, more general solution will have many, several phi solutions. Yeah, but this is at least one possibility. Okay? But this is this is a possibility, but we have to check several more things. The reason is that this is not the only term in the potential. Okay? Because the potential, this is just D term for the U1. Okay? Then there is D term for every other gauge. The unbroken gauge loop is SO 26 times U1. There will be D term for the SO 26 gauge. Right? Every generator will have a D term. Okay. And then there are 8 term potentials. Okay. And if those involve phi I, right, you have to make sure that those terms remain 0 as you are switching on phi I's on this side. Okay. So just by looking at the D term, you cannot say whether there should be such a vacuum or not. Right? Even if there is a QI for which Q over QI is less than. Is this clear? Now it turns out that this theory does have such phi I, so let me just say why. That what one can show is that this theory has a chiral multiplet. Which is singlet of isopodic group and has dual charge. Now, the fact that it's a singlet of SU26 means that it cannot appear in any other beta. Right? Singlet means it doesn't carry that charge. Okay? So the SU26 D terms does not involve this part perfect. Right? So at least those kinds of transfer potential will not have to worry. Okay? So you only have to worry about the F terms. Right? Put the F terms contain this field. Is that clear? You don't have to worry about this, but what I'm saying is that suppose these things were they are also states which are fundamental to SU26. Right? Suppose you try to switch on those vacuums or some values. Then what is going to happen is that this doesn't have the linear term, but there will be like phi I star TA phi I square term, right? And if you now switch on vacuum expression or phi I, then those may be non-zero. Right? So you have to guard against those. Right? That because you want to switch on. If you want to switch on phi I, non-zero phi I, right? You have to make sure that none of the other terms in the potential become non-zero when you switch this.
Otherwise, you have to resolve it.
Yeah, otherwise you have to bring back resolve
it. With both phi I's.
Exactly. Right? So the fact that these do not appear in the other D terms, that helps because then you don't have to worry about whether those terms can be non-zero, right? Because you are setting up every other field to zero anyway. Yeah, now these fields you can switch on and it doesn't change the potential. Is this clear? Okay. So let's call this field.
Only too many symbols are used.
It's a phi naught. So F term, what kind of F terms could possibly be dangerous? So if we have, for example, a term like phi naught to the n, okay, these are certainly dangerous terms because you calculate delta to the n phi naught mod square, then you will get a phi naught to the power 2n plus 1, so phi naught to the power 2n minus 2, and so those terms obviously will square, right? You cannot give vacuum expression or value to phi. But these terms are not present simply because phi naught carries u1 charge 2. These are simply not U1 invariant. Not U1 invariant. Okay. So the other possible terms are the form phi naught to the n phi 1. We are looking at interaction terms because, of course, in the mass basis they are diagonal anyway, so n greater than equal to 2. These could be problematic because del w del phi naught mod square will carry mod phi naught to the power. Okay? So, again, if you give vacuum expression or phi naught, we are in trouble with these terms. But In order for these to be there, I1 would have U1 charge. Minus 2 times L minus 1. Sorry, minus 2A. Okay, and if you use the fact that n is greater than equal to 2, that's minus 4, minus 6, minus 8. These are the possible U1 charges that phi 1 may have. And from general conformal field theory analysis, one can show that there cannot be any massless scalar, massless tidal multiplet, with U1 charge minus 4 and whose U1 charge is magnitude 4 or half. Okay, it's just inconsistent with various bounds in conformal field theory. Right? The U1 charge, I mean, there is sugar of our contribution to energy quantum tensor. Right? And that itself violates the bound. Right? There cannot be a massless scalar with this charge, this U1 charge. Okay, so that basically says that there are no problems of this scale. So if this particular scalar, which is a singlet of HO26, has that, and the charge is positive. Okay, we have conventional charge is positive. So this says that if C happens to be negative, okay, because U is positive for this field, okay, so this says that if C happens to be negative, then you can get possibly a non-trivial solution, vacuum solution, where superspectral will be destroyed. Okay, in the quadratic vacuum, supersymmetry is not there, but in this new vacuum, well, it's still quadratic. Okay, in the sense that its field expectation values are small, but we see from this that the field expectation values will be of order gx. So the original quadratic expansion, which was a series of gx square, will now be upset, right? Because now psi classical is of order gx, so the various terms in the expansion will have terms of order gx. But it is possible in principle that you can restore supersymmetry by switching on vacuum expectation values of this type. Okay, this is the lesson from low energy field theory. Okay, of course you have to check if C is non-zero, then what C, the sign of C is, etc. And then we have to look for solutions of this kind. Okay, but if this possibility exists, then this you cannot study in conventional quadratic theory. Right, because conventional quadratic theory only tells you how to calculate amplitudes around the quadratic vacuum, okay, and not around a generic vacuum, right, which is not a solution to the classical field differentials. So we'll try to see next time how we can analyze this in the context of off-shell string theory that we have been studying.